Greeting, we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Progressive Internet Radio. Fair rock in your world.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. I'm trying to stop this. I don't know what I did, but okay, I know what I did wrong. I didn't do anything wrong, but I've got the thing playing. So welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair. We are cooking tonight. It's kind of an old home week type of night. Peter is in the wing waiting. And later on, Jane Doherty, the star of the TV show Dead Tenet, is going to be on. She's a friend of mine from Plainfield. She is an incredible psychic. She's got some hot things coming up. So we've got a great show. I graduated from Metuchen High School. And they call it Brainiac. The Metuchen's kind of like the Brainiac county or city or town in New Jersey. Very artsy for a time. We had a lot of people who lived there and became really famous. And, you know, so I have wonderful memories of the Forum Theater there. And we're going to bring Peter on in a minute. I want to remind everybody that animals need help. We have a lot of animals that are being just dumped, especially older animals are being dumped in shelters. And it's obviously it's because as an animal gets older, just like a human being, their health starts to suffer, and then it costs money. Every time you go to the doctors, you got to shell out money, you know, and people just feel that it's not worth it for their animals. So as they see them getting older, they're dumping them. There are some beautiful animals that really don't have any terrible health problems in all the shelters, and they've done nothing but get old. You know, it's bad enough when we see kittens just being you know, dumped there and puppies and all, but then when you see older animals just being dumped or neglected or thrown out of the homes and abandoned, it's terrible. It's terrible. Captain Yokin from the SPCA of New Jersey has been asking people to help him find whoever abandoned the dog out into the middle of nowhere. Please, people, if you see this kind of behavior, report it. This is unconscionable, and animals deserve better than this, and we're supposed to be better than this. So please, if you see animals being dumped, if you see animals being abused, neglected, please report it. And if you have room in your heart and your home and you can deal with it, maybe go down to the local shelter and give an animal a second chance. And that's my animal thing for tonight. There's going to be a big zombie run. It's info@zomberace.com. And it's in Pennsylvania. And there's going to be obstacle courses and everything. I think it's April 26th. It looks like it is going to be really, really, really cool. So if you're into wanting to be a zombie and run an obstacle course, or you want to watch zombies run obstacle courses, or you want to watch victims run away from zombies, knock your socks off. Check it out. It's zomberace.com. It's out in Pennsylvania. They're going to organize one in New Jersey. There's a lot in different states, but it looks really cool. It looks like a lot of fun. You can even camp there for the weekend and try to live amongst the zombies. This is pretty funny. A robber broke into a Russian hair salon, and the owner was a 28-year-old, but she has a black belt. She subdued the guy by beating the daylights out of him with karate, tied him up, and she fed him Viagra for 3 days and made him have sex with her. She released him after the 3 days, saying she had taught him his lesson. She bought him a new pair of jeans. I don't know what happened to the other jeans. Maybe she cut them off. I don't know. But she also gave him 100 rubles, which is $31 American. Big money over there. And she let him go. And the first thing he did was he ran to the police, told him he was sorry that he tried to rob her salon, but he reported her for keeping him as a sex slave for 3 days. So now they're both under arrest. He's under arrest for attempted robbery, and she's under arrest for holding him a prisoner and a hostage for 3 days and forcing him to have sex. I thought it was hysterical. That's one way, I guess, to get even with somebody who's trying to rob you. I don't know. You know, if that's what you're into. With that, I'm going to bring on our guest because he's waiting here. Before we do, I want to let everybody know that the music we're going to be playing tonight is going to be reflective of people from Metuchen. Robert Hedges played Juan Esposito on Welcome Back, Carter. Robert graduated from Metuchen High School the year before I did. He was a very sweet man. He was a very nice man. He died 2 years ago from a heart attack. Another person that graduated with me was Jack Walden. He was a jazz and rock musician, a composer, a producer, a vocalist, and he was a multi-instrumentalist. And he worked with Foreigner on the song I Want to Know What Love Is. He did the synthesizers. And he also worked with Whitney Houston, Saving the Day. He did the arrangements for that song. He was a very nice young man as well. We had a lot of very gifted, talented people in my senior class at Metuchen High School, and I loved Metuchen. It was the perfect small town. You had the Forum. You went to see your movies there. You know, you had the record shop. You had Costco's. It was this ice cream parlor. It was the perfect small town. We had the 4th of July parade, the Memorial Day parade. It was perfect. I can't think of a better way to grow up than having a small town like that, that you could just literally walk downtown and there you were. I also went to school. My sister graduated with David Seth Kotkin. That's K-O-T-K-I-N. He was a geeky little kid who lived in the apartments where we lived. His father owned a haberdashery store on Main Street, and the world now knows him as David Copperfield. So that gives you an idea of the kind of talented people and gifted people that I went to school with. And we have another very gifted person with us tonight, Peter Loewy, right? Loewy, we pronounce
it? Yep, that is correct.
And welcome to the Lair, Peter.
Well, thanks. It's I've never been to the Lair, but it's good to be here.
A few throw pillows, you know, once you get over the water dripping down the walls. It's cool. It's a nice place.
Has anybody been to the Lair other than you?
Yeah, a lot of people have been to the Lair. So please introduce yourself to our listeners.
Oh, God. All right. I'm Peter Loewy, as you said. I have been the producing artistic director and founder of the Forum Theater for about 25 years now. I did go to Metuchen High School. David Kotkin was my classmate. Mark Hedges went to school with me, who was Bobby Hedges' brother, and Mark, I think, now is a surgeon or an emergency room doctor in Colorado. Bobby passed away about a year ago from a heart attack. He was living in Metuchen at the time. We were supposed to be working on a project together, and it just didn't, it obviously didn't happen, so... Right. He was a very sweet guy. So we did. You're right.
Yeah,
you forgot a person. I don't know if anybody remembers Mannix. But Gail Fisher was Mannix's secretary on the TV show Mannix many years ago. And she was also from Metuchen. So you see, we have quite a few celebrities.
I'm telling you, you're an actor, right?
No, I'm a director. I direct and produce.
You're just strictly a director?
Yeah, strictly. I don't act. I get nauseous, so I decided not to go into acting. But I do, you know, I produce and direct theater, many musicals as well, mostly musicals. And I also, you know, the Forum is also an art house now. I show a lot of independent and foreign films and do some horror as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. You remember what it was like in downtown Metuchen when we were kids? You went into a record store and you actually got to listen to the record if you wanted it. I mean, I would go in there and buy Elvis Presley and all the. It was a perfect little town, wasn't it?
It actually was, and we had a lot of different stores. You know, you're talking about Costa's Cottage. I had my first day to Costa's Cottage. I think I was eight. And I can't remember what I ordered, but I know she ordered the lobster, which I thought was a big mistake. But I went to Costa's Cottage. We used to go to, there was a fishmonger in Metuchen. People don't even know what a fishmonger is anymore. We had a deli, a great deli. It was Marmac Shoes was downtown at the time. It was actually a thriving community with a great downtown. And unfortunately, over the years, we've got a little too many empty stores in Metuchen, and I think things need to be revamped with a little more imagination in downtown Metuchen to get it going again.
Yeah, you've got a great little Irish bar going there. I saw that, and
oh, Haley's,
I plan to stop
Haley's
by and see that. Yeah.
Right. We've got some very good restaurants downtown, and we've got a plethora of nail salons. You know, you just can't have enough nail salons. And also pizza parlors. There's also a plethora of pizza in downtown Metuchen. So, you know, you can get your nails done and eat all the pizza you want. But there are also some fine restaurants and, you know, of course, the theater, so we all complement each other. You know, it's...
Right.
It's trying to get the council to understand what we do at the Forum and how many people we bring into town that I think really needs to be addressed. But it still is a great town. It's safe. There's parking. You know, there's a couple of good bars now in town, which is always good. And the theater.
We have a chat, and we've already got one question up. Stanley is asking in the chat, and we're kind of jumping ahead because we want to talk about the history of the Forum, but when did you acquire it?
1984, I acquired it. The theater itself was built in 1928, and it started out, I'm told, because obviously I wasn't there, I was told that it started out as a place where one of the owners of the building, I don't know which one exactly, he built it to keep his wife out of the house. And I think that, I don't know what he was doing in the house while she was at the theater, but there were a lot of presentations of that time in the theater, and I've gotten all sorts of stories about who performed there in vaudeville when it first opened in 28, Abbott and Costello being one. You know, all of these are, we're not really sure because there's no record of any of this. And then when talkies came in, when pictures came in, it became a movie theater, and that's what it was ever since until I took it over. Although we still do movies.
Mm-hmm. And you stopped them?
No, well, we stopped them for a short while we were doing, we used to do 5 shows a year at the theater. And, you know, now obviously everything's been cut down in all the theaters. Nobody's doing that many shows anymore. But we do a lot of kids' theater, and, you know, I still show the movies, though, because I have love for film. And, the cinema's a passion of mine, and we show foreign, domestic films. I try to bring in a real cross-section of films and try to handpick the best films that are out there.
Well, I've got to tell you something. What was it? It was right before, I think, the hurricane hit us. Sarah Karloff was promoting her father's Frankenstein and Bride of Frankenstein, and they had it in East Brunswick or
that's
New
correct.
Brunswick
yeah,
or
I
something
remember.
At the Regal, right. And I know Sarah, and I went and saw it, and that was like a standing ovation. People are hungry to see these old movies back up on a huge screen again. The place was packed, and it was just, at the end of it, everybody just stood up. The only thing that happened that was a little funny was everybody since then has also seen Mel Brooks' Frankenstein, Young Frankenstein. So when the old blind man is playing the violin, everybody started giggling because we all remembered that scene from Young Frankenstein. And you could hear everybody starting to snicker. But once we got over that, it literally everybody stood up and started clapping because we have not seen those movies on a huge screen in 60, 70 years, for God's sake.
Absolutely right. And actually, he was about to make espresso, which he didn't get to make in the original Frankenstein. But I would love to do that.
I know, we were giggling.
If Karloff wants to come to the theater, I'd be happy to do that kind of screening with her there. That would be great. So if you talk to her, let her know I'm interested.
Yeah, I don't know how it works. I guess whoever owns the rights to it, Universal, they're the ones that set it up.
I can get the films. If she would like to talk, we'll do an evening of her father.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'll get a hold of Sarah and I'll push her over your way. The films, give us plays. I was looking at the plays. And anybody who wants to look up the forum, it's forumtheaters.org. And
it's forumtheaterarts.org.
Right. And let's just look at some of these 1983-84 Merrily We Roll Along. An Evening with Robert Klein. He's been there a lot. Hi, is he a big supporter?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't had him there in a few years, but he was one of the first people I booked in because I was such a fan of Robert Klein. And I loved his comedy so much I could relate to it. So we brought him in, and he was great. And then eventually he did his HBO special there. One of his HBO specials was filmed at the Forum. A lot of my people, you know, that come to the theater over and over always remind me that they were there. It's amazing how many people were there, you know, when he shot his HBO special. So Klein was, I should get Robert back. But he was great to work with.
Who else have you had there? I see that you have East Street something. They're a cover band for The Boss, right?
Yeah, we did. We did a couple of bands about 2 years ago, you know, cover bands for some of the big groups, and then we also presented people such as Amy Mann performed at the theater, and Theodore Bacall years ago performed at the theater. It's been it's really, we've had a lot of people in and out of those doors. Jackie Mason has performed a couple of times at the theater, who's always crazy and always fun. He's a lot of fun. And, like I say, we produced a lot of plays. Merrily We Roll Along was the first musical we did at the theater. And then I, you know, many years later, starting in June, we have a new show called Respect, A Musical Journey of Women, which I directed in Florida, in Chicago, in L.A., and it was hugely successful, so I decided to do it at the Forum.
And what is it about?
Respect is, actually, it's an interesting concept. It was originally conceived by a professor from Tulane University, and it is how the women's movement and lyrics in music have mirrored each other from the turn of the century to today. And it's got some great standards, you know, that go all the way back to the 20s, all the way through, you know, the disco era and up to today. So it really is a lot of fun. It's for women. It's got multimedia presentation, and it's wall-to-wall music. and it's just a great time. I mean, it's you know, it's and it's not just for the ladies. Believe me, men will love it too, and they can bring their dates, and their dates love that they brought them to the show. So it's really a great time for everybody, and it's a great boomer show too, baby boomer show. But younger
yeah,
people,
some of the songs is "Someone to Watch Over Me," "I Will Survive."
Yeah, we talked.
"These Boots Are Made for Walking," "I Will Follow Him," "What's Love Got to Do with It," "Hero." Yeah, there's. I mean, anybody who loves, you know, that kind of 70s, 80s, 60s music is going to love that.
Oh, they're going to love it. I mean, it was hugely successful in Florida. We ran for 2 years down there, which is incredible. And then in Chicago, too, it was hugely successful. But interestingly, I never did it here. I created it with the writer, worked with her on it quite a bit, and I just never did it before. So I figured this was the time. And June is a good time to see one of these shows because it's just, you know, it's light, it's fun, it's interesting, and very entertaining.
How did you get, we've got like 4 minutes before a break, but how did you get back to New Jersey and so involved in this?
Well, actually I was touring a show. I rented the theater out for a short period, and then I was touring a show called The Kid from Brooklyn, a story about Danny Kaye. People who remember Danny Kaye, one of my favorites. And we did it out in L.A., and I was touring it. We did it in Chicago. It was incredibly successful in L.A., and we were there for 8 months, which is unheard of in Los Angeles. So as I was touring around, I decided I was getting tired of the touring, so I came back to the theater and started producing theater again. Originally, when I took over the theater, I was working on Broadway on 42nd, the musical 42nd Street and the musical Barnum. And the theater had become available, and when I asked if it was for sale, you know, they said they would sell the building as long as the people that took over the building kept it as a theater, either a movie theater or a live theater. And I promised to do that, so we got the money together, and the rest is history. So that is originally how I got the Forum Theater. And now I ended up back.
And you, did you just sit there and say, gee, I want to own that theater? I mean, it's a lot of work.
It's ridiculous. People have no idea how to do it. I mean, really, they don't. And even with the movie, you know, the cost involved in running movies at the theater are incredible.
Yeah.
People would be amazed at what it costs, you know, to do that and keep the building open and publicizing it and everything else. It's and keeping the toilets running. I mean, it's a lot of work. And but well worth it when I see people leaving the theater and enjoying themselves and saying, I'm glad you brought. We just had a film called The Gatekeepers in, which is a documentary about the Israeli Secret Service. And when people leave the theater, they thank me for bringing it in because I bring in a lot of stuff that other local theaters won't. So it's also very satisfying.
Okay, we're going to go to break. And in our first break, I've got, of course, the commercial, you know, which is my promo for the show. And then we've got Robert Hedges, the actor who played Epstein on Welcome Back, Carter. And it's the first clip is from Welcome Back, Carter, and it's where Epstein is trying to get Mr. Carter to get in a business with him where he gives him fake passes, hall passes and stuff, and passes for tests. And it's only like a minute long. And then we're going to have when he was on, when Robert was on the Donnie and Marie show, and back then Rocky was the big movies, and Marie plays Rocky's girlfriend, and of course they're different names because Robert is not the best boxer in the world. He's like the fourth or fifth worst. And it's you have to envision they're in this skating rink, And he's dancing around trying to act like this tough boxer talking to this girl. And it's pretty funny the way it goes. But he was a very sweet man. He was always a very nice, polite man, very gifted. And I'm sorry that he passed away, you know. It's life, you know, and as we get older, I don't know what it is, but we see more and more people pass away that we love. So we're going to do those two clips, and we'll be right
There's
back.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
There's no place like home. There's no place like
This is Mo inviting you to visit me at my lair. Mo Banchi's Lair Visionary Talk Radio airs every Tuesday night live on GCRinternetradio.com. Tune in at 9 p.m. Eastern Time Zone. Topics A to Z, Mo Banchi's Lair on GCR Internet Radio. We're rocking your world.
Just try to stay out of my way. Just try. I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
Tell you what I'm gonna do. You lay a little of your bread on me, and I'll invest it for you in my phony note business. It's my big season coming up, midterms. And if I could offer a note with your signature, Gonzo, we go through the ceiling. I can see it. We can go national.
Epstein's note business. When you care enough to forge the very best.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I like it. I like it.
Sit down, Epstein!
In a poignant scene from the critically acclaimed motion picture Rocky, the hero, a third-rate prize fighter, takes his newfound girlfriend to an ice skating rink and talks the manager into renting it for 10 minutes. In our version, Rocco is a fourth-rate fighter, so we've only rented it for 3 minutes.
Hey, Francine, huh? Come on, why don't you wait up for me, okay? Oh, yeah. Hey, come on, this ain't the first time I took a dive, huh? I wanted to be an Olympic champion, you know? I wanted to win me the gold medal, huh?
What was your event?
It was a figure walking, you know? Whoa, hey. That was a long time ago, you know? Long time ago.
Are you sure you're in shape for the big fight?
Hey, come on, Francine, you kidding me? Today at the meat lock, I punched out a cow, huh?
Cow?
Yeah, she gave me milkshakes. You know, I wanted this shot all my life, Francine. It's been a real struggle to get here, you know? Ever since I grew up, you know, I really grew up in poverty. You see, I came from the wrong side of Philadelphia. It was Camden. Yeah, my mother, you know? My mother, she would have taken in washing, but we had no water. So she took in drying, you know? It's a real struggle to grow up, you know? But I got a shot, and I want to be the champ. Hey, how'd you like to meet my sparring partner, huh?
Sure, Uncle.
Yeah, you betcha,
sure.
She's right over here. Hey, Francine, I want you to meet Elsie. Elsie, this is Francine. Say hello.
Hello, Mr. Cal.
Yeah, there you go. I've been working out every day at Angelo Vespucci's meatpacking plant. There you go. You hold this. Watch this, huh? Hey, come on. Get up and fight. What are you? Oh, my. I want to forget myself sometime. Hey, you know.
You're good, Rocky.
You betcha. Tell you, Francine, I'm going to go the whole distance this time, baby. I tell you, I'm going to be champ, you know? I can feel it. I'm going to be the champ.
Here you are. I knocked him out.
Hey,
he was the number one contender.
Hey, I got a shot at the champ. Me, Francine Progresso, I'm gonna be somebody. Hey, Rocco.
What?
Rocco, yeah. Hold out. Hey, I'm gonna be somebody.
What are you talking about? That was a cheap shot.
And welcome back to Mo Banchi's Lair Visionary Talk Radio on GCR. I was just explaining to our guest tonight that the station is in Missouri, and I'm not. And that's the way we're keeping it for right now. I hope you enjoyed those little clips with Robert Hedges. He was an incredibly talented young man. And did he work a lot with you on projects with the form?
No, he didn't, because of the fact that he got Cotter right after... I'm not even sure he graduated. It was right in his senior year that he got Cotter. But I did go out and visit him when he first got the role. He was older than I am. And, you know, we had fun out there. And he was coming back, actually, to do a one-man show. And we were starting rehearsals. It was a new show. It was going to be a world premiere. But he had terrible knees. You know, and most of that was from football injuries, because he was a big football player in high school, and he hurt his knees quite a lot, and that obviously catches up to you with arthritis and cartilage and everything else that starts to go. So he actually was going to get, I think, a hip replacement, which he also had problems with, and off of football, and knee replacement, but obviously that never happened, and his health got worse and worse, and I think this was his second heart attack when he passed away. So, you know, it was, unfortunately, he was a time bomb, and he just didn't, you know, he just couldn't get through it, which is too bad. But we were going to do a show at the time, and so it didn't happen.
Yeah. So tell me more about the form. You have children's classes. I don't know anything about acting. Do you have acting classes and that kind of thing there?
Well, we have a program for kids called Stars on Stage, and it's mostly for kids 8 to 14, and we teach them every aspect. It's during the fall and winter and spring, it's a 10-week program. In the summer, we do an intensive 5-week program. But it teaches them everything from auditioning for a show to, you know, to performance. We do 3 or 4 performances at the end of the class. And we do musicals. This one we're doing next is called And the Tony Goes To, which is a musical review of, you know, a lot of the Broadway songs that the kids love to sing, kids recognize. We also teach them some classic stuff. So it isn't just Disney, it isn't just Beauty and the Beast, but it's, and we go back to more classical theater. And they really love it. The kids do very well. We limit it to 20 kids a class. And it's very personalized training, and we've been doing it now for about 5 years. So, you know, we've covered all the shows, like One Little Mermaid, we've done that. And we've you know, tried to create a different show each time for these kids so they learn every aspect of musical theater, and they love it. It's a lot of camaraderie and building self-esteem, that kind of thing. And we love doing it, and the kids love it too.
Yeah. Do you? I remember Metuchen High School. You know, I was always a choral. I didn't get into the acting bit, but the kids that did the theater part of it and the acting part, they had to do, like, they had to learn everything from building props to scenery to doing it all. You know, they. You wore many hats. Do you do that with them too, right from the scratch?
Yeah,
you're going to have to learn that?
Yeah, we try to teach them all, because they're younger kids and not high school kids yet, but we try to teach them aspects. Let me tell you, they leave the class knowing more about song and dance and scenery and musical theater and auditioning than a lot of kids that are going to college now. And, you know, we take pride in that. We try to cover everything with these kids. And, you know, in high school, you brought up high school. It's truly unfortunate that so many schools have knocked out their arts programs and programming and education because of lack of funding. And unfortunately, yeah, you know, the arts are always the first to get cut. You know, I'm as big a football fan, or, you know, I love baseball, but the truth is take one game away for, you know, to save some money on the budget, and there's going to be a riot. But when the arts programs are cut out of the schools, nobody seems to care, which is truly unfortunate. So I'm a big advocate of trying to get the arts back into schools so kids have a, first of all, get away from iPads, iPhones, computers, and, you know, actually have interaction, human interaction with other people and other kids and forming, you know, their creativity at an early age so that, you know, they grow through life with much more creative process in their head instead of a technical process, which, you know, is IT. Mm-hmm. So I'm a big advocate for that. And that's why I wanted to do the school at the theater as well.
Yeah. You don't have, like, adult classes or theater? I mean, I don't know how it all works.
Yeah, no, not yet. I mean, we have been talking about it, and I might start a comedy class, too, a stand-up comedy class, too, because I think people need to laugh a little more these days. But right now we don't have adult programs, but we possibly will in the future.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot of money. Let's get back to that, because it is. It's an older building. As you said, it was built in the 20s, and that means it requires a lot of work to keep it, you know, so that the inspections go through and everything. Do you do most of it yourself? Do you, you know, have volunteers?
No, I do most everything. I mean, I have a small staff, very, very reliable and helpful employees, and they keep the place. They're very proud of the place, as we all are, and we try to keep it, you know, as up to date as possible. But, you know, it is an old building, so things are there's either a leak from the roof, or there's constantly problems with the exterior or whatever it may be, and, you know, we're constantly maintaining it. But that's what you do. That's what you have to do. But we're always up for donations, and we're always up for support from people in the community who would, you know, that can do carpentry and can help us out with some of the other issues we have in the theater. But, you know, at the same time, the building is in great condition because that's how they built it in 1928, mm-hmm. you know, not like today. Yeah. And the acoustics in the building are tremendous. You know, we had Jefferson Starship in there about 2 years ago, and, you know, it's quite impressive, the acoustics in the building. So people love coming back, like Kenny Vance and the Planetones. Kenny started Jane the Americans in the 60s, and Kenny just performed there 2 weeks ago. You know, they love performing there because it's intimate. The acoustics are great. It's handicapped accessible. You know, it's got all the elements of a nice night out in the theater without spending a fortune. And you can go downtown and get your nails done.
Well, the nice thing about it is the train runs right through there.
Well, that's the other.
And that's another.
Right, where we're located, you know that. Where we're located, I mean, we're on the main train line. You know, it's three blocks from the theater. From you know, Washington to New York. I mean, we're on the, you know, you can easily get anywhere from Princeton and New York to the Forum in 40 minutes and less. So it's, you know, it's a great area, plus the parkway, the turnpike, Route 1, we're in the middle of everything. So it's a great place to come to.
Yeah, and going back to the vaudeville acts trying their stuff out there on the way to Asbury Park and the shore points where there were huge audiences during the summer, and then in the winter they'd go into New York. So it was on the way to, and it behooved them to go to these smaller towns and work on their stuff, you know, and see what was funny and what wasn't. You know, and a lot of the Paper Mill Playhouse, you know, they put on stuff there. Newsies is one of their big success stories, you know, and then they move out and they go into Broadway, you know, and that's the lovely thing about these theaters.
Well, yeah, I mean, the truth is somebody can come into the Forum and produce a show at fraction of the cost that would be to do, you know, a workshop in New York or a reading in New York. They can get a full production at the Forum, you know, for what it costs to do a two-week workshop in the city. So we do have advantages, and you can do it out here without getting reviewed, if you don't want to be reviewed. And, you know, it is a it could be a terrific tryout house, and that's true. Newsies started there. And, you know, our audiences are great. I mean, it's a sophisticated audience. They're, listen, we're 40 minutes from New York, and people are used to going to Broadway, and they're used to seeing top-notch theater and performers. So, you know, we have a very eclectic theater scene in New Jersey. So you've always got to keep reinventing yourself, and you have to stay current. I mean, that's the main thing.
Well, I've got an idea kicking around my head, and before I forget it, I'm going to say it. Sal Litvak, who made Saving Lincoln, you know, he had that in New York, in one place in New York, but I think that the Forum would be the perfect place to see that. It's on iTunes, and you can rent it, so you can get an idea of what it is. But it's about the guy who appointed himself Lincoln's personal bodyguard, and it is a phenomenal movie. I've seen it 3 times. It is just an incredible historical gem that kind of got stuck in the closet by all the big movies, you know, that came out about Lincoln. But that kind of thing is perfect for the Forum, because you're going to see something on the screen that normally would end up going right to DVD or something, and you miss so much when it's compact like that, you know?
Yeah, that's a great idea. I'll look into that, absolutely. You know, I do take requests, too, from people that want to see certain films at the theater. I even had a contest for people to suggest films, and the winner, you know, is going to get his name on the marquee, and we're going to show the film in July during our little, we're doing a little Italian weekend of Cinema Paradiso, Life is Beautiful, and Fellini's La Strada. So, you know, I do take requests from people, and if I can do it, I do it. And, you know, if I can get a 35-millimeter print, because I like to stay away from digital cinema, and 35 is starting to go out, but the older films still are on 35. If I can do that, I'll, you know, I certainly take requests. So I will look into Saving Lincoln.
When you talk about the old films, I mean, what is it, the one with Cary Grant, you know, when To Catch a Thief, stuff like that. Those movies, all those movies were meant to be seen on a big screen.
Absolutely.
You know, and nobody shows them anymore.
No, I know. I mean, there's the Film Forum in New York, which I love, and that's one of the places you can still see some, you know, some fun films, some interesting films, and I try to sort of do a mini Film Forum at the Forum. But, yeah, you're absolutely right. Those films need to be seen. And it's, you know, it's tough sometimes getting an audience. But once they know you're going to show top-notch films, we did a great evening of Breakfast at Tiffany's, where we also had drinks at a local restaurant after the show, and people came dressed up. And it was a great evening. So I want to do more of that.
Yeah. You had the Rocky Horror Show back?
A live show, yeah, we did. It was, and I might
Did you show the movie? Acted out?
No, it was a live stage production. It was the musical, the original musical. And it was great. People loved it. But I used some video clips and things like that on our big screen, and it worked out beautifully. I might do it again in October
I'm telling you. Yeah, I mean, because a little theater down here, but it's a regular movie house, you know, like, you know, the new ones, and they do it every Saturday night, and my kids are always after me, Mom, you know, let's go see it, and I says, I didn't see it when it came out. I mean, I don't want to see it, but I might go and see it if you have it.
Well, it's a lot of fun, but you do have to clean up a lot after the movie. So, you know, from people throwing, you know, bread and you know, newspapers and all sorts of stuff. But it is a lot of fun. It's a good amount of fun.
That's another thing. You know, do you have to walk down and say shush? Do you have somebody with the flashlight that goes? When we were kids, they go down and say, "Be quiet. You have to be quiet." Do you have to do that, or have times changed?
Well, they've changed. We usually hang them from the balcony.
You're going to be in the next show. You're a prop now.
Yeah, exactly. We can always use dead bodies. So, you know, sometimes we hang them if they really... No, we don't do that anymore. The old owners used to do that. That's what people remember, that... You know, they wanted to keep the place nice, and they'd come over with flashlights and shine it in your eyes as you were making out with some woman, and then tell you to, you know, get your feet off the seats. But we don't do that anymore. If people want to make out, they can make out. In fact, we sell popcorn.
So...
We do sell popcorn buckets with no bottoms. You know, it's not easy to get those anymore.
Oh, okay. I saw on the site or in a news thing or something, you're talking about making it so maybe people could bring in like a bottle of wine or something.
Yeah, I'm trying to do that. You know, we've been talking about that with the balcony, to turn it into more of a sort of a lounge area where you can bring up a bottle of wine. We only charge a cork fee, and you can see the movie and in lounge chairs, that kind of thing. You know, not movie... Mm-hmm. Not like the AMC eat-in theaters, you know, which I can't stand. It drives me crazy. But something.
Yeah, you listen to people eating through the whole show.
Yeah, I can't do that. I can't have my eyes burning from wings while I'm watching, you know, Schindler's List. There's something about that that makes me sick. So I stay away from those theaters. But I do, you know, I like the idea of having some little tables upstairs with chairs where you can bring a date, have wine, and we'll have pull-out beds.
Oh, okay, that sounds interesting. Pull-out beds, huh? Well, I think that I have nothing but good memories about the forum and Metuchen. I wasn't raised in Metuchen. We moved there when I was in high school, and I kind of was like a fish out of water because I had gone through the Piscataway New Jersey school system, and they were very sports orientated, you know?
Oh,
and then when I went there... Yeah, that's Piscataway, they're rough. They give a whole new meaning to sports. And so when I, even though I was in the choir and all there, and I sang in church choir my entire life, when I went over to Metuchen, I was kind of like, what the heck? You know, it was culture shock. It was a very unique town. It was... When I was there, we had Vietnam. My fiancé was on his way to Vietnam, actually. And I remember at my graduation, the valedictorian got up there and started his anti-war speech. And half of the men in the room got up, and I thought they were going to beat the daylights out of the kid. And the rest of the parents got up, and... because Metuchen does have a sports group, and then they had the theater and the artistic group, and it was, I thought there was going to be a Donnybrook right in the middle of that gymnasium that day. It got rough. It came to the point where police were called in.
That's an interesting beginning, isn't it?
It was interesting. The whole town was, it was very diverse.
Yeah, you can't do that anymore because, you know, you're not allowed anymore to talk against, you know, people like terrorists or, you know, or Al-Qaeda. We can't mention those things even though they're out there and they're murdering us because, you know, it's not, we live in a very, unfortunately,
politically
far too
correct area.
Country anymore. And I think you know, things have to change before.
Before
much worse than they are now. So.
Don't get me started on that. Yeah, it was a very diverse community, and at first when I got there, it was kind of rough, and then I kind of fit right in, and it turned out to be great. You know, it was a great end to high school. You know,
yeah, I'm sure as soon as you stabbed that kid in the hall, everybody respects him. That's probably why you made it through high school, which I think is great.
Actually, for the first week I was there, most of them thought I was a student teacher, and nobody talked to me. Yeah, and I finally was sitting in the back of the class, and I says, "No, I'm a new student," and then I was cool. Oh, okay, now you're cool.
Yeah, you weren't the enemy anymore. I know.
Yeah, actually, I had a teacher. I was in this one class. And I'm not going to say which one, but I'm sitting in there looking at this teacher. And we all, you know, the bell rings and you move. And I went up because he was supposed to be a student teacher there. And I walked up to him and I says, "You're not a student teacher." And he says, "I'm not." I says, "No." I says, "You're FBI." He says, "Don't tell anybody." And it turned out that he was there on an undercover drug thing for the pot and everything in the school.
Metuchen High School?
And I almost went, I says, "You're not a teacher," because, I mean, he knew nothing. And he says, "Don't tell anybody, please don't tell him." I got home from school, and there they were sitting in my parlor, and my old man says, "You had to tell him you knew who he was, didn't you?"
Oh, no kidding. I guess carrying that rifle was a dead giveaway, huh?
the hawk. It was wearing the hawk all the time, you know? Half of them walked around with doves sewn on in their clothes, and I had the hawk with the talons with the blood dripping off of them, and my boyfriend was in the Army, and, you know, so, I mean, I was terrible. I was one of them, you know?
Right.
So, this has been a wonderful interview. I wish you the best. I plan...
Yeah.
Yeah, I absolutely want to go and see stuff there, and maybe get my granddaughter over there and see some films on a big screen. And I wish you the best with it. And this will be on YouTube.
Wait a minute. Didn't Kenny have a question back an hour ago?
Who?
Didn't somebody have a question on your blog an hour ago?
Yeah, they asked how you bought it, when you bought it.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And you told them. Yeah, 1983. And do you have you're the sole owner, or do you have like a group of people you have to report to?
It's independently owned. No, I'm the only theater in the state, and very few of us in the country that is independently owned and operated.
Wow.
That's
a labor of love.
Yeah.
That's a labor of love. It really is.
Yep.
But thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks so much for having me.
Yes, thank you for coming on. We're going to go to break, guys, and I'm going to say goodbye to Peter. And again,
do you have the address or phone number of that Russian hairstylist?
Yeah, right. I'll feature Viagra, rape you for 3 days, and you'll never rob another hair salon again.
I'll certainly get my hair done somewhere else, I'll tell you that, because you never know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's crazy, but it is news. And the site is www.forumtheaterarts.org. It's in Metuchen. Yes, it's in Metuchen. You can take the train from South Jersey and from North Jersey and find it. It's a little hamlet between Edison and Woodbridge. And it's just a beautiful little town, and once you're there, you're going to fall in love with it. I didn't spend a long time there, but the time I did spend there was a lot of fun, and I really enjoyed it. So thank you so much. We're going to go to break, guys. And the song, let's see, Foreigner. I want to know what love is, and I'm playing it because Jack Walden played the synthesizers in the song. He was a musician. I graduated with Jack. He died way too soon back in the 80s. He was with all the great artists of the day. He had a beautiful voice. He had a great talent, and we're going to miss him forever, but his music will live on. So that's the song we're going to play, and we'll be right back. This is GCR, and we'll be right back. Let's see.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Well, hello there. This is Stan inviting you to listen to Jurassic Park, where we dig up the old bones of rock and roll, 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond, and then carefully rebury them. Thursday nights, 8 Eastern, on GCR.
And again, that was Foreigner, I Want to Know What Love Is, and Jack Waldman, a kid that I graduated Metuchen High School with, was a incredible composer, producer, jazz and rock musician. He played the synthesizers in that, and later on I'm going to be playing Whitney Houston's Saving the Day. He made the arrangements. He wrote the arrangements for that song. Very gifted people from Metuchen. And my guest tonight, my next guest is here. She had a TV series called Dead Tenets. She is one of the top psychics in the world, bar none. She is a good friend, Jane Doherty. Welcome back to the lair.
Thank you. Great to be back again with you, Gail.
Yeah, this is, you're one of the few people that knows me by my regular name. Everybody else knows me as Mo, and nobody knows me by that name. My mother didn't even call me that name before she died. She would go, well, go ask Mo, and I looked at her, and she's like, oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, I did have that name for a while. What have you been up to? I'm sure you've been busy.
Oh, yes, yes. I guess the main thing that I'm doing right now is this weekend I'll be holding a psychic boot camp, which I've done before.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, teaching psychic development. And I'm also going on a trip to Egypt. I'm leading a tour to Egypt. I'm going to Mexico City in June for a trip, taking crystal skulls with me to, that's in preparation for Egypt. And also, I'll be hearing soon about the movie being released in theaters. The movie I did in 2009, that's how long it's taken. And it is a supernatural thriller. I don't play a psychic. I play an Amish grandmother. And it is my granddaughter who sees the souls of the possessed, and the exorcist in it is Chris Atkins, who played in The Blue Lagoon, opposite Brooke Shields.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm patiently waiting.
And what was the name of that again?
The name of it is called Amy. She Can See the Possessed.
Right.
It's very, it's cool because we're all, it's set in Amish country, and they're very superstitious. So it's very believable because it's almost like an Amish tale in a sense. So the special effects took, I think, 18 months to complete. That's how long, because of, you know, the various things with it. So I'm anxious to hear that date. I'm just praying it's not while I'm in Egypt. That's all.
You know, I had Sal Litvak on, and he did the one Saving Lincoln, and I says, well, all right, from beginning, from concept, to getting it released, how long did it take? And he said 11 years.
Oh, my God.
That's a big chunk of a life. A big chunk of a life. Well, at first he was fighting against, what's his name, the one that just did Lincoln. He kept saying, oh, I'm going to do a Lincoln movie. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to. So they were holding up but still working on it. And then finally it was kind of like, all right, either go or get off the pot, you know. And they finally said, that's it. We're just going to plow ahead and go. But, you know, it takes a long time from concept to getting it out to the public. It does. It takes a long time. And I know you're going to be good. Are the Amish people going to go and watch it?
I have no idea. just taping it was a scream because we were actually in Amish country. They were renting a house that was Amish. And to me, it was hilarious because I'm in Amish clothing, and I had people coming who were extras to the movie, things like this, who all thought I was the real Amish woman of the house. It was funny.
You were hit on by, there was somebody
was
interested
hit on.
In you, wasn't
that,
there?
That's right. that, I think, is a moment that startled me in my life.
I know, it's those one-in-a-lifetime moments, because when we were in Ireland, I got hit on, and I thought to myself, you can be half-dead, and these guys over here in Ireland will hit on you. I mean, you know, hey, is she breathing? Does she have a pulse? You know, really. It's just, I think that's one of the funniest stories you've ever told me is about that guy kept checking you out, man. You're a hot-looking Amish woman there.
Well, that was, to me, one of the most startling moments because it shocked me. I was leaving the barn watching part of the taping going on, and there was mud, and I was picking up my dress so it didn't drag the ground, and he just came right into me, you know, and said something. And I was just absolutely startled and mortified at the same time. So it is a moment in my life I don't think I'll ever forget. And you have to understand, playing an Amish woman, I have no makeup on, and that is so contrary to me. I'm that girl that's always got to have makeup on from when I was a teenager.
Yeah.
So to me, not having makeup on, playing this part, and having that happen was just hilarious to me. So you never know.
Yeah, they're used to it. Yeah, they're used to very plain, you know, no paint, no powder.
Right.
You know, nothing fancy. You got good bones. You got your teeth. That's enough. Are you a widow? Or as I got asked, do you still have sex? I just sat there and looked at this guy like, what?
Oh, my God.
I guess that's the next test, you know? If he got that far, he said, are you interested in sex, you know, then you're in trouble.
How did
the Mexico, well, let's do the boot camp. What is involved with the boot camp?
The boot camp is an all-day psychic development workshop. I actually have four levels to it. I'd say about 32 hours in psychic development. So I'm teaching people all the ways that I use to open up my psychic ability. So it's my secrets, exactly how I did it. Because I was not, my psychic ability wasn't opened, and I developed it. So that's what I'm doing. I think to give people a quick idea or a synopsis of how they can open up psychic ability, because we all have it, and I'm living proof that it is a natural ability because I opened it up. What most people don't think of is that there are really skills involved. It's just like any other talent. And when it comes to psychic ability, the skills are awareness, observation, then you have concentration, and of course, interpretation and sensitivity. Now, concentration is a big key. I don't read cards, so I'm not going to teach reading tarot cards. I'm going to teach receiving information clairvoyantly or clairsentiently, you know, one of these ways or all of these ways. So the biggest thing is concentration. And that's mm-hmm. what people often don't have, to be able to stay in there long enough to concentrate and to have patience. When I receive psychic ability, my eyes are closed. I'm looking down in the middle of my forehead, which is like the hallway that I go down, and I walk down there, you know, with my mind, and I wait until an image appears. So if you lose your patience, you're not going to get that image. Sometimes images come quickly, sometimes it takes a little bit longer. So concentration is a big key. And those are skills mm-hmm. I'll be teaching. The other thing that I often say to people is you can't just do a meditation or an exercise. It's a process of change. There's something else you have to do, and that is your own self-love. Because you've got to pull away those emotional layers or those emotional scars that you've developed over the years that doesn't make you trust. And, of course, to receive guidance or to give guidance, you have to have that total trust to know when you receive something, you know, what it is. And if you're filled with fears or you have a lot of emotional scars, you are going to interpret that image based on those fears. The biggest example that I can give you quickly is somebody sees a bridge in an image. Somebody who is afraid of bridges is probably going to interpret it as, oh my God, you're going to have a car accident on a bridge, or you're going to see somebody jump off of a bridge. Something bad. The other way of mm-hmm. interpreting that image would be that the bridge is a symbol, that it's a bridge between two things. It actually may be a positive sign where you may be trying to get to, and finally there's that bridge that's going to put you to where you want to be. And mm-hmm. so these are the things that you have to know and be able to discern and to develop your own self-love and get mm-hmm. rid of emotional
issues. Let me ask
you,
do you get, like, well, I call them flashes. Mm-hmm. They're images that you're totally thinking about something totally, you know, irreverent, whatever, you know, it doesn't mean anything, and all of a sudden there's bang, there it is, you know, and you sit there and go, what the heck, you know, why,
right.
you know, why now, you know, how do you tell people how to handle that stuff?
Well, you do have control of it. It's, you know, these are, sometimes it happens naturally, and it's important not to be frightened over it. Just know it's a natural mm-hmm. process. I tend to teach it more with control because I want the person to go into their own little ritual so you don't have, so you're not open all the time and start to receive information on people and things like this, because you can't walk around life being bombarded with images and impressions. Mm-hmm. So I try to teach people to have their own little ritual. Like for me, it's, I'm going to have my crystal skulls in front of me. I'm going to say my quick prayer. I'm going to hold a person's hand, and I'm going to get quiet, and I'm going to be writing as I receive. So I don't, mm-hmm. I keep myself, if you ask me to do a reading on the spot, I'm not going to do it, because I have to get myself quiet and down in order to get into that, what I call the psychic mode.
Mm-hmm. You've mentioned them a couple of times, your crystals. Could you explain the crystals to listeners?
Yes, sure. What I have are two small ancient skulls. They come from the Mayans. And during the ancient days, the Mayans used them in their own rituals to divine the future, to summon the spirits. They would almost every night after sundown take their crystal skull and divine with it, but for guidance as to making decisions and things like this, or to summon the gods and the spirits. Also, the Mayans used them in warfare, which I found very interesting, because the crystal can absorb energy, and they would put stones in the eyes of the ancient crystals after they've captured, you know, the sun. And then when the enemy came, they would hold it a certain way and then take the stones out. And what would happen is it would cause a temporary blindness in the way the sun mm-hmm. would. They would be able to maneuver it with the sun and direct it towards their enemy. I just use them in the traditional way of divining for the future and summoning spirits and as a form of my own protection and for energy. Now, another one has been added, which is a story, and that is why I'm also going to Mexico. In 1996, when I went out first to take the skulls on a tour into Massachusetts, what happened is a girl at the end of my tour came to me to get a message from my crystal skull for herself. But instead of getting it for herself, she got it for me, which turned out to be 6 pages long. And while I was at the Crystal Skull Conference this year, just before it, I found the paper that had all this information, and I read it. And in that information, she said, I understand what I had to do and the meaning of this until after 2012, and that I was to get an amethyst skull. But I could not buy it. It would be given to me. And it would be about the size of Maya. As I'm saying this at the table, one of the other guardians, Sherry, said, an amethyst skull? And I said, yes. And so what happened is she knew a couple who had an amethyst skull and used it for years, taking it to sacred sites. The couple broke up, and the owner of the skull gave it to Sherry and asked that she find the next owner for it. And it is an amethyst skull, and so it is now mine. The third skull is with me, and that's when I'm supposed to go to sacred sites with them and put them in the triangle, in the three, at the sacred site to help to open up the energy. So the first place I'm going is Mexico City to the pyramids there, the Pyramid of the Sun. And those pyramids are aligned with the Great Pyramid in Egypt. So this mm-hmm. will be the first sacred site I take them. And then, of course, that will prime them for the work that they have to do in Egypt. Because in Egypt, I will be doing the first ever seance held in the Great Pyramid. The tour group will be participating in this.
Yeah, I was just going to say, is this trip open to others to go to?
Oh, yes, absolutely. It's, you know, it's a regular Egypt trip, but, you know, there's an Egyptian tour guide, but then there's also me doing all the spiritual things, conducting the seances, doing the meditations at each temple, doing a group past life regression. So this is open. I'm currently, you know, marketing it for that, and this will be the first mm-hmm. time a tour group participates in a seance. Wild.
Okay. And how do people get a hold of you to sign up for that?
They could look on the major site, which has the entire itinerary, which is timeofanewera.com.
Okay. Yeah. And when is this trip going to be? This is like September? No.
September.
No, that's...
Yeah. September 15th okay, to
yes.
the 28th. It was changed
okay,
three
that's
times
gonna
the
be,
date.
Yeah. The Mexico one, can they go on that with you too?
Yes, there are, yes. The best thing to do would simply be to email me for either trip. And if they can't remember the name of that website, mm-hmm. they could email me and also for information on the Mexico trip. And that's my name, Jane Doherty, Doherty, at comcast.net.
Mm-hmm. The boot camp that you're going to have, the psychic boot camp, is April 27th, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. It's you got to get a hold of Jane through the same thing, janedougherty@comcast.net. And where is that going to be, in Plainfield?
That's going to be held in South Plainfield, yes.
Okay, South Plainfield. And it's about opening your psychic centers, identifying your psychic personality strengths, gain confidence and make better decisions, meet your guides, angels, and more. Space is limited. I went, and I know I bring this up every time you're on, but I went to one of your classes at Middlesex.
Mm-hmm.
And why I went there was I wanted to see what kind of people go to these kind of classes, and I found a really huge variety of people that go to your classes. One woman, her son had been killed before the prom, and she just could not get past it. She wanted to see him again. Another man was diagnosed with Garrick's disease, and you know, he wanted to know there was something else there besides just dying. How do you, when you get people like that, does it put a great weight on you to try to help people like that? Because I know when I have to help people, I'm very mindful that, you know, they're already in a very delicate position.
Mm-hmm.
And they're grasping at straws, literally. And I'm always very conscious of every word that comes out of my mouth when I'm dealing with people. How do you handle it? Because you give classes all the time in this.
Really, I think by now it's so ingrained in me that it's almost second nature. I don't ever get drained. And I think part of it is because I will have my crystal skulls or something to that effect. And I just do what I have to do. I just get into it and help the person as best as I can and give them some pointers, mm-hmm. and things like that. You know, there's been healing aspects where I'll use the crystal skulls for healing and bringing in God's healing energy, things like that.
Mm-hmm. I know, because the one woman, she kind of went into a bit of a trance and said she came out of it crying, saying she saw her son and he was in a white robe, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed to help her. It really did seem to help her to know that he's there, you know, and
sure.
And that. But it, you know me, I'm the skeptic from New Jersey. You know?
And I was too until I opened the ability to prove whether it was real or not.
Yeah, I know it's real, but I don't always buy everything, you know. I'm very discerning, and you know, I worry about people. What can they expect when they go to this boot camp to start out with?
Well, they're going to get all the basics. There's you're going to discover what is their personality strength or their psychic strength. What are they more, clairvoyant, clairsentient, clairaudient, things like this, the meditation, mm-hmm. skills, the, you know, how
you're
to
gonna do the bag trick? You're going to do the bag trick?
I may. Usually I do that more in the class for college. This one I get a little bit more detailed with. So there are other,
yeah.
kinds of exercises that I have them do to actually force open the psychic ability. And I'm probably also going to include the crystal skull this time and teach a,
mm-hmm.
scrying technique and use the crystal skull that I have as part of that in opening up the ability.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when I was at that class at Middlesex with Jane, she did the bag trick, and in it, she's got a bunch of items in there, and she tells you what's in the bag, but she doesn't tell you what she's holding. And I thought, you know, okay, so we'll do it. And I ended up getting all but one right. And she says, our skeptic got the best score of the whole class. And I thought it was funny. But, you know, I really enjoyed the class. But, again, I was there to see what kind of people are interested in this, and a lot of the people that were in that particular class had they had issues going on in their life. They weren't going to be the Long Island psychic. They didn't.
Right.
That's not what they were after. They were after answers, and that. You know, that's a whole different bag, you know. We're going to go to break, and then I'm going to put you on the hot seat and ask you what you think of the Long Island psychic and and this always being on, you know, never shutting down. And then there's the other chick that, when I'm wearing my hat, that means they can't talk to me. That always floors me, too, that chick. But we're going to go to break, and the last song that we're going to play after the commercial is going to be Whitney Houston, Love Will Save the Day, and that's because Jack Walden, a kid I graduated with in Metuchen school, high school, he arranged it for Whitney Houston. He worked with a lot of the big names, and he passed away in the 80s, and I'm kind of old home week this week, so with that, we're going to go to break, and we'll be right back.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair. We're back on again, and as you know, I'm learning the boards. Our guest tonight, Jane Doherty. So, Jane, we're going to talk about the Egypt and the Mexico and what you're going to do there and all that, but what do you think of all these TV psychics that are out there?
You're going to do that to me, aren't you?
Do you need a special... Do you need a special hat so that you know when
you don't need a special hat to that's when your psychic ability is. That's just a gimmick. That's what that is. I don't know much about the Long Island psychic as far as her ability. I'm sure she has ability. I happen to be a more of a spiritual person, so I get annoyed when it's all show in the situation. Mm-hmm. The personality just comes across that way. And I'm sure mm-hmm. that in the editing, they do things, or they prepare mm-hmm. things before. Because that's one thing I learned doing a reality TV show. I have to honestly say that there was nothing on my TV show that was ever doctored, or we didn't know ahead of time anything about the house that I was doing the investigation in, because the executive producer was a documentarian. So he kept strict to those rules, but I learned from all the workers about what goes on in reality TV shows and how they are scripted, and they're not really reality. So it upset me, you know, to realize that that's what's going on. So my
yeah.
view of reality
well, you
TV
actually-
show changed.
You actually went up against them because they wanted you to move faster and make up stuff, and you said you wouldn't do it when you had the TV show.
Exactly. You know, there's just no way I would do that.
And I've always respected you for that.
Thank you. No, you can't do that. I mean, I don't care what they say. I've spent too many years in this field trying to understand it and teach people about it, and then, you know, also from the ghost perspective, to turn around and just do something for the sake of TV and entertainment, it defeats what I worked mm-hmm. for all these years. So
right.
that's important to me.
Yeah, and this baloney of just walking up to strangers and, oh, your mother is talking to me, and I'm going to be very honest. She's lived in Long Island her whole life, this chick. tell me she doesn't know that the local bakery has been in the family for the last 40 years. She probably remembers the old lady that you know, started it. Oh, did your grandmother have something to do with this bakery? Oh, give me a break. Give me a break. You've lived there your whole life. If you don't know who's been running the local bakery, you're a moron, you know? But they try to make it look like, oh, I just got this, and she's talking. And it really upsets me because it gives a false
image of a true psychic.
Picture.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it does.
It makes them look like
most
morons.
Most people don't realize. I was president of the Jersey Society of Parapsychology, so there is something that I always taught. If you have a psychic come up to you, that's the typical gypsy ploy, is you have a psychic come up to you as a perfect stranger on the street and start saying, I know this about you. That's an invasion of your personal privacy. And to me, that really is a negative thing. You need to ask permission. You need to want that. So the whole premise of just walking up to somebody like that on the street kind of turns me off because I know the spiritual principle behind it. So it concerns me, but, you know, it's TV. From what I hear, I mean, there's a lot of people that really like her, but I also hear there's a lot of people that are now starting to question it. So,
well, thank God. You know, I was starting to think that a car bomb was needed, you know, really, because, you know, this baloney, and everybody wants to get on TV. I had somebody come up to me and say, oh, my grandson said, I wish that Ghost Blunders, that's what I call them, would get off the TV so my daddy could get a TV show. Now, I know this guy, and he's only been even involved in learning anything about spirits for maybe 3 years, and suddenly he deserves a TV show, you know? And these people, you know, you've been in the trenches since Holzer, for God's sake. I've been in the trenches since the 70s. For God's sake, we've put in our dues, and we're not running out there saying, we want a TV show so we can prove to the world we can talk to dead people, you know? I mean,
I know.
People, Zach Baggins and all of them, you know, I was doing this before his old man put the dirty proposition to his mother, you know, and it, you know, I don't understand where it's entertainment. I get that part, but these people started taking themselves as real, and as people said, oh, they're the real thing. They didn't say, well, no, we're not. We're guys that got a TV show. You know, we're not the real thing. We're really savvy business people, and they didn't stop it. And there's a lot of people over the years, and they've written books and stuff like that, and the same kind of thing has happened, and it just gets me because then I get called in to patch up stuff that they screwed up, you know, and talk to people because ghosts are natural. Ghosts are the most natural. You live. You're born, you live, you die, you're a ghost. Ta-da! Congratulations, you made it. I mean, it's nothing that's abnormal, you know?
No, right.
So, yeah, and I was just, you know, wondering your opinion because the hat thing, the one chick with the hat, well, when I'm wearing my magic hat, that means they can't talk to me. Okay, and where is your bottle of Thorazine? let's get that Thorazine going there, Tootsie. So anyway, Egypt, how did all this come about, the Mexico and Egypt stuff?
The Egypt trip was kind of interesting. It's something that I've known for years that I'm supposed to go at the right time. You know, I've had spiritual messengers come into my life, so I received an email from a company actually in Poland who are their video production company who did the documentary on the Sphinx and the redating of it and all of that. And they got me because Dead Tenants is still playing internationally. And so it played all in Poland and in Egypt. So that's where they got my name. So they contacted me first to go to Poland. Was the first thing, and then I said, okay, I'll do that, and they go, well, hold on to that. We want you to do something else. and we'd like you to lead a tour to Egypt. And from the psychic perspective, from the spiritual psychic mm-hmm. perspective. And you know, they have their pull there where they could get the Great Pyramid for 2 hours alone for us to do it, to do an investigation, see if you can capture, you know, an EVP or pictures. And in the Sphinx, we're going inside where the public does not go. And we have a half an hour alone in there. And in there, he did that for me because I received a vision in a dream years ago about a certain symbol that would be in the Sphinx that had to do with the Hall of Records, the opening of a door there. And then again, I saw that symbol in 1999. So now that we're going inside the Sphinx, in order for me to see if I can find it, now we only have a half an hour, so I'm going to have the image, the symbol, copied so everybody on the tour can have it, because so that each one can go in there, we can be in there together, just keep looking to see if we see anything that has that symbol. So that's how it mm-hmm. came about. It's really because of Dead Tenants. It's a TV show.
And the Sphinx, what is the symbol there? Do you think that they were built by extraterrestrials, or that extraterrestrials instructed the Egyptians how to build these pyramids and Sphinx, and that there's signs left there by them?
I think there's a connection, but I will say this, that my view of extraterrestrials are different than they were a few years back. I feel that there's spiritual beings, multidimensional beings, and that we are probably related to them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what we're going to find. Yes, that's what I think that we're going to find in the Hall of Records, that our true history, and that's what it is. We come from these spiritual beings. We're all part of that. So it should be interesting. But this is how it came about. And, of course, we're also doing, a spirit investigation in the temple in Luxor at night and in the Philae mm-hmm. temple. And we're going to be doing, seances in both of those. Besides the meditations at each place, that the gods and goddesses, in order to tap into that energy and have a spiritual awakening, it will be asking for clarity and courage to reawaken our true self. Also focusing on healing, activating the codes of light within, and honoring our divinity. Then there'll be a meditation to raise the vibrations of each of us, and also. Mm-hmm. asking for clarity and to renew love, self-love, or to attract a divine love of a partner for single tour goers. And in Kom-Ombo, there will be the activate the gift of balance and the to transcend the energies of polarity, the darkness, and then another meditation to empower us for strength and the ability to give and receive. So there in each place, We're tapping into the energies of those gods and goddesses that presided there and what they are known for. And these meditations are based on that. And in essence, we're going through an initiation. We're going to be on a Nile cruise. And the Nile is considered by some to be to represent almost the chakras, the backbone, so to mm-hmm. speak. And that each place we go opens up our psychic ability, another level of knowledge and psychic ability. So it's really almost like an initiation, in a sense. And then it will culminate in the Great Pyramid with that final seance that would be. And then what a lot of people don't know is that Jesus, Moses, Plato, so many of the greats, religious and otherwise, all were initiates in the Great Pyramid, in the Mystery School. And that Jesus and Moses, after completing the initiations, actually started their ministry. And there is information that, it's where God can talk to you. It's very interesting, and I've done a lot of research because I had to write 10 different articles for various spiritual magazines on the spiritual aspects of Egypt. So it required me, of course, to do research. And it's fascinating. In Abydos, in that temple there, you have a plaque in there that many feel is something of the future, where there is images of a spaceship and a helicopter and things like this. In some of the temples, the pictures, I want people to look at the hand movements, because there is some research being done now in the hand movements. We're going to place our hands in those same positions, and that they are produce the opening of healing ability and things like this. So it's fascinating. Egypt is just an unbelievable place. It goes way beyond the mysteries, and it's all the spiritual, because your ancient Egyptians that's where higher consciousness began. It's the root of civilization. And it was based on the supernatural. So just going through the trails of ancient Egypt on the paths and in the pyramid, all that energy from the past is still there. So as you experience it, you are actually opening yourself up.
Are you going to have the skulls there with you?
Oh, yes, yes. They're going to be there, because I'm going to use them in the old-fashioned way of summoning spirits in the Great Pyramid.
Be careful you don't bring Caesar out. You know, he's liable to still be pissed.
No, I will. I'll only bring out those of the light in what may be. You know, what is needed for a message, or perhaps to ask for some information about the secrets and the mysteries. And then on the cruise ship, I will be doing a group past life regression for the people on the tour, and a channeling session and messages to each of them.
So night times, you'll be sitting on the boat doing, you know, your thing, and then during the days, you'll be going out. You're going to be allowed, we're running out of time, but you're going to be like one of the few groups allowed in there at night into the pyramids and stuff, right?
Right.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Who did you have to bribe for that?
Well, the guy who's the organizer, he's very well known there in Egypt. So he's got certain kinds of permissions and things like that you have to get from the government.
Not Zakawi there. What's his name, Zakawi?
Yeah, I don't think he's there anymore. But whoever it is. And, I mean, even on Facebook, I've become friends with the owner of the Mina House, which is directly across from the pyramids, who's wanting to know about spirit. It's interesting. A Muslim who wants to know about spirituality. You know, he's realizing certain things. Very fascinating to me.
Okay, so your psychic book camp is Saturday, April 27th, and people can get a hold of you at janedougherty@comcast.net.
Correct.
And that's going to be in South Plainfield, New Jersey. And then you're going to be the magical and spiritual tour of ancient Egypt, September 15th through the 28th. That's a long tour. It's, what is that, like 12 days?
14 days.
14, woof.
Yep.
And that's September 15th through the 28th. Again, you can get a hold of Jane, and she'll get you the information. Time of Anwer, A-N-E-W-E-R-A.
Yeah, time of a new era.
Yeah, and Friday, May 17th is the Mysteries of Mexico, and again, you can get a hold of Jane, and she'll let you know. Jane also is on Facebook, Jane Doherty. You can get her a hold of her there, and her site is janedougherty.com. So if you want to uncover the spirits of ancient Egypt, March 9th to the 20th, no, that's the wrong
date. The date has been changed.
Yeah.
To the 15th.
Yeah, the date's been
September.
Changed. Right. September 15th, 2013. By all means, get a hold of Jane. And thank you so much for coming on.
Oh, you're welcome.
Travel safe. Travel safe.
I will.
Okay. And I can't wait to have a yawn when you come back so you can tell me what happened.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, you got
it. All right.
Unless you're going to put it in the book. You know, if you're going to put it in the book, fine. Just pitch the book to me, okay? How does that sound?
Okay, sounds good.
Okay. God bless you. I love you.
You too.
And be safe. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye now.
That was very cool. We have 5 minutes left, and I want to remind everybody they can find me at www.asylumsgate.com. If they have questions, if they want to visit me at the site, it's a free registration. They can, you know, come over there. And I want to remind everybody that the GCR has great shows all week. We have some spiritual typey shows. We have a lot of rock music, a lot of country music. We have something for everybody. So check out the schedule page and find a show that, you know, clicks your boots and that you enjoy. I'm trying to remember everything I need to remember. Today, there was a false... somebody hacked the Associated Press Twitter and sent a Twitter out saying that there was two bombs that went off in the White House and that President Obama had gotten hurt, and it turned out to be completely you know, wrong. Nothing happened. The president was fine. I don't know how the whole world can just fall apart the minute they hear something, especially with the internet, because the internet is just so unreliable. Our hearts go out to the people of Texas that had the fertilizer bomb go off. It was an explosion. It wasn't a bomb, but it was like an atom bomb going off when it did. I saw a video of a man with a child in a car, and he was trying to get pictures of the roof falling in and almost got him and his child killed. He's a moron. There's a lot of morons out there. I don't know what happened. I thought the hippies were going to fix all this stuff, but I guess they didn't. But anyway, I hope everybody is safe. I hope everybody just kind of chills, takes time when they hear something in the news, just take time to digest it before you run around and scream the sky is falling. Again, tonight was a little bit of a homecoming for me, you know, memory lane, remembering David Seth Kotkin, a little geeky kid that lived in my apartment complex in Metuchen, and now he's known all over the world as David Copperfield, the illusionist and magician. He grew up to be a good-looking kid. You wouldn't have thought it when you saw him when he was a kid. You know, I remember seeing him walking home from school and thinking, wow, you know. But he turned out to be great. Robert Hedges. There's a lot of people. Barbara Bono, the New Jersey State Senator from Metuchen. A lot of actors. James Florio became governor of New Jersey. Poets, a whole lot of people, Lonnie Price, actor, writer, director, basketball, great Marvin Webster. So many people came from that little town and, made history. And I'm very proud that I graduated from that school. So, with that, I'm going to say next week, we're going to have Ansel Farrar back on. He is with Hollingsworth Productions. He is director, writer, and producer of Dr. Mabuse, starring Jerry Lacey, which will be released next month. Dr. Mabuse is the forerunner of a lot of the bad guys. Before Lex Luthor, there was Dr. Mabuse. He was a man who could get into your head, and he could get you to do things that nobody else could do. He could convince you to bomb things. He was a fictional character created by Norbert Jacques and a novel called Dr. Mabuse. And there were three movies made by Fritz Lang about the character. This new movie is a totally new storyline. It's going to have Laura Parker from Dark Shadows, Catherine Scott, Catherine Lee Scott's going to be a Jerry Lacey, played again Sam. A lot of people remember he was a phenomenal Bogart in Woody Allen's Played Again Sam. He's going to be the notorious doctor, and he's a pulp kind of magazine style villain. He's a really bad guy, like Fu Manchu and that kind of thing. And I think one of the movies that reminds me a bit of him is Dr. Caligari, where he was a real sick dude and got people to do all kinds of weird things, you know, and bomb things and all. So we're going to enjoy having Ansel back on next week. And then we're going to have Chad Hopkins on the 7th, talk about everything going on at Lyndhurst and Tarrytown. Then Carolyn Quinn is coming on the 14th. Rose, Mama Rose's Turn is her new book, and it's a story about the mother of Gypsy Rose Lee, who turned out to be a notorious stage mother, driving her daughter almost to a nervous breakdown. And then we're going to have Kathy Benjamin coming on in the 21st. Funerals to Die For. She wrote a whole book about odd traditions and new traditions and crazy stuff people are doing at their funerals. And then Rod DeSailer, The Boat, the book of truth. It's some kind of a spiritual book. We've got a whole lot of things going on, and in June we're going to have the great-granddaughter of Molly Brown, who was on the Titanic. She's going to be on. We're going to have a whole lot of stuff coming on, and we're going to have a Civil War show. David Brown's returning to talk about his grandfather, who was in the Civil War, and some of the artifacts from then. We got a lot of stuff coming on, so I hope you guys will tune in, pass our links around, and I hope everybody has a good night. Thank you for listening. God bless you all, and good night.
Visiting me at my lair. You can always contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for visiting, and God bless you and yours.